The following program does not necessarily represent the views and opinions of Reality Radio 101, its advertisers and sponsors, or its listening audience. Listener discretion is advised. Good evening and welcome to this House of Musicians radio show with your host, singer, songwriter, and founder of the band, Inner City Outlaws, the Baritone Bear, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. To get on board, send us an email right now. Our email address is instudio101@gmail.com or thishouseofmusicians@gmail.com.
Oh, an HD rockin' day. Oh, the classy chassis way.
And now, right to your host of this House of Musicians, the Baritone Bear, Mr. Barry Smith.
Hey, welcome to this House of Musicians, everybody. We have Gary. I'm so stoked, man. We have a special guest on tonight on our show. I've been listening to his band and him for like 40 years since I was 15. So I'm super stoked to have him here. I'm talking about the notorious Greg Godovitz.
Thank you very much. Yes, the notorious. I love that one.
The notorious Greg Godovitz we have with us, Gary. So, hey, Greg, how are you, man?
Well, you know, all things considered, I'm in great spirits and we're healthy and we're, you know, wishing the best for everybody to stay healthy out there and practice social distancing and wear your gloves and your mask.
Absolutely. And you're still moving forward with your music stuff at home and whatnot as well. So that's amazing. Now, Greg, you were born in 51. And let's start right from the beginning, man. You met Brian Pilling in high school when you were 13. From what I heard, you had the first Beatle haircut in high school.
I did, it was just a little modest Beatle haircut, you know, it's over your ears and you got a, you know, the fringe in the front, but it still caused a lot of concern because like I'd have to leave a class and sort of skulk down the hallways hoping that the gym teachers wouldn't catch me, because if they did, they, you know, threw you up against a locker and said, get that ridiculous haircut. Even my music teacher kicked me out of music class the first day because he wanted me to stay at the end of the class and said, you're not to come back until you get that ridiculous haircut. And I said, well, my mother says, he says, I don't care about your mother. I don't want you coming back. And I said, well, you know, Beethoven had long hair. And he said, yeah, you got a bad attitude. Don't come back anyway. And that was the end of my formal training as a musician. So,
and it wasn't even that long, was it?
No, but by standards of the day, it was long, you know?
Absolutely. So you met Brian and Ed, and you guys formed a band called Fludd, and it had its roots in the Pretty Ones.
Was the first band.
Right, okay, yep.
I was 13. Brian would have been 14 or 15. Ed was 16 or 17. He came back from England. To give you an idea of what it was like back then, Brian and I were in a greasy spoon restaurant because his big brother was returning from England that night. And we went in there and we sat at a booth and we were so excited and talking about our plans for the future and what we were going to do with our music. And Ed finally showed up and I'd never met him and he's tall. He's in 6 foot something. And he had an English pea jacket, double breasted pea jacket, and a beautiful Brian Jones Beatle blonde hairdo. And, you know, Brian, you know, introduced me to him, and then he jumped into his arms, and Ed, you know, he said, where you been? Ed says, the bus drivers wouldn't pick me up. So it was like that. And then Ed said to me, how come you guys haven't ordered anything? And we'd been there for an hour. He called over the waitress and said, we'd like menus. And she said, we don't serve your kind in here. And Ed said, I don't want my kind. I want a hamburger.
Isn't that crazy?
It was actually like that for us in 1964. I mean, you know, if you had these little tiny Beatle haircuts, you were a pariah of society, you know?
Yeah, and possibly getting beaten up here and there.
That happened a lot, too. Not when Ed was around, because he was the toughest guy I ever met in my life.
Oh, that's great.
I always started the fights, but Ed finished them.
Now, you were inspired by the Beatles. Tell me a little bit about why and how.
Well, you know, I grew up in a house of music. My mother sang occasionally on the radio during the war, in World War II. Both of my older brothers were into the first generation of rock and roll. My Uncle Raymond lived with us for a while in the corridor in the basement, and he had all of the original Sun record 78s. And he had a little Victrola, and he would play all the Jerry Lee Lewis and the Elvis stuff. And I remember, you know, goofing around with one of them one day, and of course I dropped it on the ground. It was a hard shellac, and it shattered, and he was so angry. Considering that they're each worth about $50,000 today, I can understand his, you know, his ire about it.
No kidding. So worth 20.
My brothers were into all the early. One of my older brother, Ted, he didn't like Elvis. He liked Pat Boone for some reason. But my brother, Gary, was a bit greasy, and he liked, you know, Jerry Lee Lewis and Little Richard and all that. And then one day he brought home this album with a picture of four guys in silhouette with these little mop-top haircuts. And I went, they look stupid. And he stuck the needle on the groove. It Won't Be Long came on, and my life changed instantly.
No kidding.
It was like a light bulb going off. I said, "This is my music, and this is what I'm going to do for the rest of my life." And as it turned out, that's exactly what I did.
Yeah, very fortunate. And who didn't love the Beatles? I mean, we all still do. It's just it'll be an endless thing with the Beatles. 1,000 years from now, they'll still be around. Now, Brian and Ed Pilling went off to Birmingham, like you just mentioned, and spent some time touring as backup for Cat Stevens in 1970, and then returned and reunited with you, John Anderson, and Mick Walsh to create Fludd. So let's talk about that for a bit when you guys all got together there.
Well, Fludd was already going with another bass player. I think his name was Graham. Can't remember his last name. He was a guy from out west. And I saw them at a high school, Ed and Brian, you know, because we played together. They just come back from England. I was playing in blues bands at that time. I got a real crash course in playing Chicago blues and the Muddy Waters stuff, Junior Wells and all that, with guys that went on to become Whiskey Howl. So I was always lucky that I worked with really good musicians, you know. And so I went to see them at a high school, and I mean, they were just so charismatic, you know. Ed, when I worked with Ed and Brian, Ed Pilling was the drummer in the band. And now he was out front, and he was very, very Robert Plant, although
Conference
cool hadn't come along then.
Wow.
And of course they knew Robert and John Bonham from Birmingham, where they lived in England, you know.
How cool is that?
In fact, when Led Zeppelin first came over here, I was on stage with them right behind John Bonham. Ed and Brian couldn't get into the rock pile, and I went out back to smoke something or other, and they were there, and they said, we can't get in. And they said, well, go tell John Bonham that we're here. So I knocked on the dressing room door, and it opened up a bit, and I could see Jimmy Page with these hot chicks inside. And Bonham came, and he goes, what do you want?
You're kidding.
I said, Ed and Brian Pilling. And he grabbed me by my shirt and said, where are they? And he tore me down the stairs and jumped into their arms outside. Robert and John ended up spending the night on Ed Pilling's floor at his apartment in Scarborough. And the next year they came back and they did it again. So
legendary, man.
We sort of got it together really fast. Once I joined the band, it was definitely their band. I was the third voice. I did all, you know, when you play this Fludd song that we're going to play, all the high harmonies in those days, I was just a kid, right? So I could really hit the fifth notes in the chords.
Sure.
And it was, we had a really good vocal blend. Of course, you got the two brothers that have this tremendous blend, like Oasis or the Everlys or Ray and Dave Davies. you know, they had this great blend. And I just, because we started out playing together, I was like the third brother, you know?
Cool. And so with this, you were 21 when you yielded a top 10 Canadian hit, Cousin Mary, like 21 years old.
Yeah. Well, we went to San Francisco first and we recorded, at Pacific Recording with the great Freddie Cotero. Now Freddie had worked in San Francisco and had worked with Santana. He'd done work with Barbra Streisand, with Mallow. He was the go-to guy for engineers back in the day. And we had Adam Mitchell, who was the main singer of the Poppers, which also included Skip Prokop. He was the producer on the album. And the first hit that came off that album was Turn 21, which was a really, really nice, very, very poppy record. The problem with the first album is that Fludd Live was like The Who. We were a really aggressive, loud rock band. But when they recorded the album, and it's the first time I ever heard that fantastic studio lie that producers and engineers give you, I said, well, you know, this doesn't really sound like us. And they said, don't worry, we'll get it in the mix. Well, you know, these days you can do that. But back then, unless you had a guitar that was distorting, you weren't going to get it in the mix because you couldn't do that back then.
Right. No kidding. That's crazy. I got a couple emails. Sorry. Go ahead, Greg.
No, please. Let's hear from your people there.
Well, I got a couple emails, man. And I got one from Thomas Mitchell. He's a Canadian actor. He was in Gangland Undercover. His name was Bullet. He is a friend of mine. He was also he's also coming out in the new Saw movie with Samuel L. Jackson and Chris Rock. So he's got a nice part in that. So this is from Thomas Mitchell. He said, play me some Goddo. And he's asking, ask Greg if he moved back from BC. He's interested to find out why he moved west to begin with. Was it because of a chick? So
tell Thomas he's very astute. I was living up north of Toronto in Richmond Hill, Lake Wilcox, and had been there for a couple of years. And, you know, I had my radio show, Rock Talk, at CFRB, which was doing really well. I was playing sporadically with Goddo and then some other people, Bob Sagarini and people like that. And my girlfriend came and said, I've been offered this job out in Calgary. And, you know, for once, you know, as selfish as I can bloody well be, I said, you know, it's always been about me. So, you know what, let's go to Calgary. And I dumped the radio show and everything that here. And we had a big going away party at Jeff Healey's club and everybody showed up and it was great. And I moved to Calgary. And within 6 months, she threw me out and I was stuck in Calgary. And then I got the locals knew I was there, but I wasn't sort of allowed to go see them. Once I was on my own, they embraced me with open arms and I started producing people. I was playing with all the hot gun musicians. Paul Dean from Loverboy was living there, who's a great friend of mine. And then finally, Paul and I started putting a band together. And I guess we'll get to this a bit later in the show. He said to me, these new songs you're writing are the best things you've ever written. Let's record an album before I leave and move back to Vancouver. So it wasn't Vancouver for me. It was Calgary. And I loved living there. But then it was time to come back. I got my lovely Mrs. Claypool, my wonderful gal, the girl I should have been with my whole life, was in front of my eyes the whole time and I didn't see it. And she was here and she came to visit me and I came to visit her. And then I decided, yeah, it's time for me to come back home. And I'm really glad I did.
Yeah, absolutely. No kidding. Well, let's get back to Fludd for a minute. We are going to go ahead and play Cousin Mary, man. Everybody knows this tune in Canada. You want to just touch on that a little bit before we play the song?
Well, we did the first album, like I said, in San Francisco. And then we did the second album at Manta Sound, which was down on Adelaide Street in Toronto. And I remember with this particular song, Andy Hermet, that owned the studio, happened to be a banjo player. And he heard what we were doing. And I guess he mentioned it to Brian and Ed. And the next thing we know, we had Andy playing the very distinctive and memorable banjo part that's on Cousin Mary. And then, of course, Ed played that great hooky harmonica line. And this song has been on the radio over 250,000 plays since it was released.
I don't doubt it. I've probably heard it on there that many times. I don't doubt it.
I'll tell you this. I wish I'd have written it.
Yeah, no kidding. No kidding.
Ed is still drawing royalty checks from it.
Royalty checks. That's just good for him, man. That's amazing. Good stuff.
Him.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so let's get to it. We're going to play Cousin Mary from the band Fludd that Greg Godovitz was in. And you're listening to This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101.
And we are back. Barry, are you there, sir?
I'm here, sir. Thank you. Now, that is a timeless song, man. Just timeless. Now, Greg, Fludd planned for an album called Cock On, and you wrote a song before that called Cock On. Can we talk about that for a bit? I mean, it's a high-energy, really thumping, rocking tune, man.
Well, you know, the funny thing is, we'd always planned on calling this album that Cousin Mary was on Cock On, which is just an English expression with two thumbs in the air, right on. But of course, you know, the powers that be at the record company thought it was something, you know, disturbing, something, you know, parental guidance, you know, and it wasn't, but they wouldn't let us call it that. Now, so we called the album dot, 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 on.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was an exclamation mark, but the exclamation mark looked like, it made it look like an E. So people go, why is the album called One? It was so convoluted, it was hard to explain to people what had gone on. So I wrote a song at that time based on what had happened. Fludd went out and did for Rainbow Magazine, which was Martin Melouish and Richie York's publication. We did a picture of the band with offending appendages tucked between our legs, and we were in the nude. So it was Fludd in the Nud, and they released it as a double page spread poster in this magazine, And it ended up in every schoolgirl's locker at the time. And we got banned from every high school in Canada.
Shoot, that's awesome.
So, you know, in my song that Goddo eventually recorded, the line is, a picture in the nude, the kids all think it's cool, some parents must complain, the band is banned from school.
I wonder where that came from.
Yeah, so, but Fludd actually learned that song, and it, unlike the Goddo version, which was like straight ahead, you know, hard rock, the Fludd version was very much like the Who would do it. Lots of big sweeping Pete Townsend chords and stuff. I also wrote, during that period, I wrote Chantel that ended up on the third Goddo album, but the guys wouldn't do my songs, you know? And I knew that I was writing some okay stuff. My mother finally sealed the deal because she had, we were at a party. Fludd was a very family related band. The mothers and fathers and the brothers and sisters were always welcome at the parties. And my mother sat down with Brian Pillen and said, you know, Gregory is writing some pretty good songs, you know. And he said, you know, Mrs. Godovitz, with all due respect, Fludd is my band. And when my mother told me this, I knew that the writing was on the wall, that I wasn't going to get my songs heard. And I was writing quite a few of them. And I left. And in 1975, I left and then formed Goddo.
Absolutely. And what a band Goddo was. We're going to talk about the next song. We're going to play right away. Oh, just before we do, I got an email from Paul S. Greg. He asked, does Greg still live in Scarborough, Toronto area? Thanks. Unlike a lot of rockers, they either moved to LA or Nashville.
Well, you know, I never even entertained the notion of moving to New York or LA. A lot of my friends did. A lot of my friends became very famous. No, I'm a Canadian. I'm a proud Scarberian. I live in Scarborough. I mean, you know, in our neighborhood, the Bare Naked Ladies came out of here. Two blocks away from me, Larry Gowan lives down the street from me. We like it here. So yeah, I still live in Scarborough. I've been doing a lot of work lately with regards to trying to get some business for Scarborough restaurants and the food bank and stuff like that.
Yep, I've been following your posts. You sure have. This is from Charlie N. He says, hello, Barry. Wow, what a guest tonight. I am a huge Goddo fan. I saw them in Oshawa at the Oshawa Music Hall. Fantastic. I wish that Greg would continue to tour with a band, any band, if not Goddo. Are you still touring? And he's listening from Thompson, Manitoba. That's Charlie N.
Oh, cool. All right. Charlie, his name?
Yep.
Okay. Hi, Charlie. Well, you know, none of us are touring right now. The music industry has sort of shut down because of the COVID-19 pandemic. I sure hope that it gets back to, I mean, do I miss playing live? Yes. I think one of my strengths as an entertainer is that I love to be on stage. I mean, I just live for that 2 hours of when you're on the road, where you're on in front of people and sweating and jumping around and looking like a maniac and giving the people what they want. So yeah, now the original Goddo band, I'm going to say never, but never say never. I highly doubt that Gino and Doug and I are ever going to play together again for whatever reason. But the funny thing is, towards the end of that band, I got together, Gino's son came in to play. Gene Scarpelli came in to play guitar. Now we gave him his first guitar when he was 4 years old. And he knows every single song that we ever recorded. Wow. And then our original drummer in Goddo was a guy I went to high school with named Marty Morin. And Marty came back into the band. The funny thing is that when Marty left the band after the first year to become a bus driver, and then I wrote the Bus Driver Blues, he looked so much like Doug, or Doug looked so much like him. When Doug Inglis came in, Doug was signing Marty's publicity picture for 6 months until we ran out of it. And then cool. At the end of it, Marty comes back in the band. He's signing Doug's picture. So, you know, go figure.
That's crazy. Absolutely amazing. So let's move forward and get on with this Under My Hat song, because it's already set almost 7:30. We played two songs. So much to talk about. Explain to me a little bit about this. I've listened to this Under My Hat, man, and it is just so smooth and clean. Your vocals are killer. It's got, tell me about that synth sound that I'm hearing in it, and before we play it.
Okay, well, first and foremost, I was working on the El Macambo restoration project, and also involved in the project was Eddie Kramer. Now, for I doubt if anybody listening to this show doesn't know who Eddie Kramer is, but in case they don't, if you think Jimi Hendrix, Woodstock, Frampton Comes Alive, Rolling Stones, the Kinks, Eddie Kramer was involved in the recording of all of those records and everything Jimi Hendrix did, of course. So we became friends, and he mentioned one day, "How about I remix one of your albums or your albums?" And we only got as far as the first one. So what people are about to hear here is the Under My Hat. Everything that you're going to hear was on the original record, except for the fact that we had three vocals that we never used on the original record. It was just my scratch vocal. But there was a double track lead vocal and harmony vocals. And then there's a Moog, mini Moog synthesizer that the keyboard player, who was Dwayne Ford, who was from the Atkinson Danko Ford band, also Barefoot. I met him in Montreal where we recorded the album. And he came in and played that wonderful Fender Rhodes part on it. So this is the version we should have put out, but now this is 40 years later. Eddie Kramer comes in, God bless him, and he puts together this incredible record. So I hope you people, you're going to get like a world's first here. I hope you enjoy this.
Absolutely. It is absolutely killer. You're going to continue to just to talk about it as we start the song here. And my friends, this is Under My Hat. A revised version, we'll call it, on Reality Radio 101. Greg, just continue to talk a little bit about it while we start the song off here.
So you're going to hear the original vocal. You can hear me cueing the band on this as we get into the groove of the song. And what's going to Eddie remixed the entire album. And also, the B-side of Under My Hat was called You'll Come Around. That's going to be finally when we get this thing out on vinyl and CD. You're going to hear the whole thing. So enjoy this right now. Under My Hat, Goddo with Eddie Kramer, remix.
Absolutely killer.
You got the answer. under my hat. Keep it under my hat, baby. Under my hat. Keep it under my hat. Under my hat. Keep it under my hat. Under my hat. Keep it under my hat.
You are listening to This House of Musicians with your host, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. And now, right back to Barry.
Hey, that is definitely one of my favorite Goddo songs. And folks out there, that's, you know, you're listening to it for the first time, revised version of that song, Under My Hat. So what a great tune, man. Like I said, always one, it was been one of my favorites for many, many years. Now, Greg, let's talk about, I also know Pretty Bad Boy. We're just going to touch on this for a little bit. We want to move on to your solo career, which is also a fabulous album, but let's talk about Pretty Bad Boy. I know that was a big one for you.
Can you hear me, Barry?
Yes, I can, sir.
Okay, because I've lost my audio.
Sorry. Can you hear us, Greg?
Get out of this. I don't know how I'm going to do this. Let's try this. There we go. You got me?
Yep. Can you hear us?
I can hear you now. Yeah. No,
Perfect, man. I'm just asking about, I know that Pretty Bad Boy was a big one for you. I know you got a good story with your folks and stuff about that, what you did with some of the coin from that, because I know that was a big one for you. So let's just really briefly touch on Pretty Bad Boy, because that's a great tune, too.
Well, you know, I wrote the song to sound like Mott the Hoople, all the young dudes, you know, hey, you with the glasses and all that, you know, the way he did it at the end of All the Young Dudes. So, hey, you good looking in the very front row. So that song, the genesis of it was sort of a hybrid of that and Werewolves of London by Warren Zevon. If you put the two together, you go, oh, yeah, Godovitz definitely ripped that off.
Yeah, and you sent your parents on some a couple of cool trips with when you did well off of that one, did you not?
I did, and thanks to the young kid that was on the record, I used to take Russell Nakashima around everywhere with me. He was my monitor guy, Mike. It was his girlfriend's sister's kid, and Russell was about 4 years old, and I just loved him to bits. He was such a great little character. Well, he was with us in the studio the day we recorded that, and we got to the solo section, and I couldn't figure out any sort of a guitar thing. Gino couldn't find anything. I couldn't find anything. The engineers couldn't come up with any ideas. And then I said, I think I got it. So I grabbed Russell, took him into the studio, stuck him up on a chair, put a microphone. And I said, when I point to you, I want you to say, I'm just a pretty bad boy. And he nailed it. We actually did four of them, but we only used three of them. We used the first two. Then there was a break. And then the fourth one where he goes, I'm just a pretty bad boy. And it sounded like he was resigned to the fact that he was a pretty bad boy. Well, that, it was like having the cutest kitten in the world on your record, because it sold like crazy. I mean,
yeah, man. And it, and it sounds great. I mean, it is very cute when he does that in on the song. I got an email from Doug. Go ahead.
He started coming around and playing it at high schools with us. And then we did a couple of gigs at Maple Leaf Gardens. We did a New Year's Eve gig with Max Webster, and we did an Alice Cooper one. And he came out, and of course, he stole the show.
So he would just, wait a sec, he would just come out on stage when it was time to do that part in the solo and say that.
Yeah, and he had...
I'm just a pretty bad boy. That is too cool.
The night that we played with Alice Cooper, him and I went on the subway down to Maple Leaf Gardens. We had our bags with our clothes in them. And you know, they would have sent a limousine, but I said, I hate that stuff. So him and I took the subway down.
And they let you on the subway. Your hair must have been shorter.
People were freaking because they go, well, you're playing at the Gardens tonight. What are you doing on the subway? So I'm going to the show just like you. So he would come out in his little tuxedo and he would stand there. And of course, when he first saw Maple Leaf Gardens, he said, this is way bigger than a high school. And he was only 4 years old, right? And all of a sudden, now he's in front of 20,000 people. But, I mean, you know, as soon as he walked out, the place went erupted, you know. And
sure
what I
did,
when I got the first royalty check for that, I didn't know we were going to talk about this, but I sent my mom and dad to England and France for a holiday.
Yeah, that's very cool. I saw that story. I thought I'd just mention it or bring it up so you could mention it. That's very cool. Yeah. So we got an email from Doug Robertson from the band Roller Coaster. He says, "Wow, one of my favorites for sure. Really didn't know Greg was in the band." I think he's talking about Fludd, so that's kind of cool. I also have another email here from Harley Girl 2819 just took me back to my childhood back in Aurora Arena listening to Fludd. Love them. Now folks, I know I have 1,000 emails here for Greg, so if I don't get to them, please do not be offended. Greg, we're going to move forward. I'll do some more emails in just a little bit, but we're going to move forward to your solo stuff now. What a great album, Amuse Me. Now, I want to know how you came up with that name. I know muse is a word that, you know, it means like an artist, somebody in your that you know inspires you in your artistry. But I don't know if that's the case here. I'm asking you what the title, how you got the title for your solo album.
Well, I met a girl in Calgary, and
that's what I thought.
Yeah, and I hadn't written a song in 10 years.
Wow!
And then I met this girl, and all of a sudden they just started falling out, you know. And
sure,
you know, it's funny because, like, sure, the first song was called "Searching for Love," and it's probably, you know, one of the better ballads I've ever written. But it got to the point where, like, I wrote a song about her called "I Ain't Your Jesus," you know, which was not very nice. And then I wrote a song called "Letting You Go Gets Easier Each Day," you know. All of a sudden, I became the Adele of guys, you know. I wrote the whole, you know, beginning, middle, and end of a horrible relationship. But I got these really cool songs out of it. And Paul Dean, who was, you know, working with me then, said, "These are really good songs. You should record these." So we went into the studio with all the Top Gun guys in Calgary, and this is what came out. You're going to play "Searching." What do you play? You're playing "Jealous Fool."
I'm going to play "A Jealous Fool." I just want to mention that your release date for this album, which is, you know, it was just very recent. It was May the 30th, 2019, and it was produced, like you say, by Loverboy's Paul Dean.
I don't know where the 2019 comes from, because I recorded it when I was still living. I'm going to say it's probably 2011.
Wow, that's when it was released? Okay.
I'm thinking, but I don't know. I don't have a copy in front of me. You can have a look, but it doesn't matter anyway. Anyway, it's the freshest album I've done, and these are, like, really good, you know, Calgary musicians. But pay careful attention to Paul Dean's guitar solo, because he took the tracks away, and the guys in Loverboy told me that all he did when they traveled was work on my album in hotel rooms, on planes, in the bus, backstage. And when he sent me this guitar solo, I cried when I heard it.
It's amazing.
Best thing he ever did.
Sure, it's a super album. I mean, there's not a bad song on the whole album. Before we get to "A Jealous Fool," there's a quick email from Linda T. She says, "Enjoying the radio show from St. Augustine, Florida. Loved Goddo back in the day. They do not write them like that anymore. Stay healthy, Greg. You're a legend."
Oh, what a wonderful thing to say. Thank you.
That's from Linda.
You know, if people have questions for me, we just started up a YouTube channel. So it's Greg Godovitz YouTube. And if, you know, if they go on there and see some of this stuff, Mrs. Claypool, my gal, always makes sure that I answer the questions. So if you have any questions for me, send it to Greg Godovitz on the YouTube channel.
And awesome.
And actually, tomorrow we're going to have "Under My Hat" up there, the Eddie Kramer remix, with photographs from my friend Dave Ferguson, David Ferguson, who was with us at the beginning. He's got hundreds and hundreds of photographs no one's ever seen. So it's going to be a video of "Under My Hat" with all of those photographs.
Cool, man. You know, I don't know how the hell you remember all this stuff from way back in the day. It's incredible talking to you. Here's an email from Lizzie. Now, Dave Clayton is a good friend of mine. He's my go-to man, you might want to say. Whenever I need something or need to know something, he's the dude that gets it for me. This is his wife, Lizzie. She says, "Here's a little memory test for Greg. I'm wondering if you remember back at Scarborough jamming "Under the Tree" on Westbourne across from the Lightning's house. You guys were teenagers, and my friends and I would come and sit and listen. You sounded awesome. I remember that very fondly. I didn't learn until years later who it was I was listening to under that tree. I hope you remember those days. Thanks for the memories. That's from Lizzie.
You know, one of the things that Lizzie will see on Greg Godovitz YouTube is I went back to my old neighborhood and took a guitar and played one of the songs in front of my mom and dad's house. Because, of course, there's incredible memories of you know, being 13 years old and Brian and Ed and I would be rehearsing in my mom's basement, you know, becoming, you know, living the dream, you know, starting our dream, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, so like the memories.
I'm a Scarborough guy, and there's a thing called the feedscarborough.ca. It's a food bank specifically for Scarborough. So, Lizzie,
yep,
if you're out there kicking a couple of bucks, and let's get some food onto the tables in Scarborough.
Absolutely. So we're going to go ahead now, folks, and listen to A Jealous Fool. This is off Greg's solo album called Amuse Me. And I want you to especially listen to Paul Dean, correct, Greg? Paul Dean's guitar lead in this. It's called A Jealous Fool on Reality Radio 101.
To take this moment and whisper softly in your ear, this jealous fool, he really wants you back. I hope they're the words you wanna hear.
You are listening to This House of Musicians with your host, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. And now, right back to Barry.
Great song, Greg. Great song. I have an email from Don Smith. Hi, everyone. Fantastic show. A guest tonight. A Goddo icon. Love those guys. Greg was such a showman. Great frontman. Any weird stories, Greg, to tell? And I want to hear some crazy rock stories that you have. Or one.
I thought you told me this was a family show.
Well, that's, I know, and that's the thing, eh? Maybe we can bleep out the bad words. No, well, I want you to tell me a crazy rock story. I know you got a million.
Oh, boy. Okay. I mean, yeah.
Okay.
Let's try to filter one out right now. I remember we played a gig in Winnipeg where the band was really, really big. It was the first city outside of Toronto where we could headline big gigs. And later on, we went back to the hotel. The whole floor became a party because, of course, I invited everybody to come back to the hotel. And I was in the toilet in the washroom in my hotel room with Jerry Doucette and Chris Burt Gaffney from The Pumps, which was a great Winnipeg band. And, somebody lit something up, some sort of funny cigarette. And the next thing I know, there's this pounding on the door. And I said, who is it? And they said, it's the police. I said, are you the guys that do Roxanne? He says, it's the Winnipeg police. Open the door. So Chris starts turning green. And Doucette and I are laughing because we don't care, you know. And we finish the joint and we flush it down the toilet. Bang, bang, bang. Open the door. It's the police. I said, sing Roxanne for me. So we open the door and all the smoke wafts out. And it's the hotel detective and a couple of cops. He says, whose room is this? I said, it's my room. He says, who are these people? I said, I have no idea. Throw them out. And I shut the door and lock the door. And they throw everybody out. They clear the hallway. Later on, I take about 10 people down to the pool area and we break in and get into the hot tub and the pool. And the detective shows up again, the house detective, and he goes, you again? And they threw us all out of the hotel. So the guys in the band that were actually behaving themselves, we all got thrown out of the hotel that night.
Jeez Louise.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
That's one of the mild stories.
I bet it is. That last email was from Don S. So thank you, Don, for that email.
Thank you, Don.
We want to do, Greg, man, like I said, it's totally amazing to hear your solo album, your new stuff. I'm going to go on to one of my favorite songs here we want to play next. You're Dragging Me Right Down. It starts with a lot of colorful overtones to introduce the song. Let's talk about that song and why you wrote that. It's so Goddo-ish back in the day, Goddo-ishy to me. I think fabulous tune. So let's talk about that before we play it.
Well, first of all, I mean, you heard that incredible guitar solo that Paul Dean from Loverboy did on Jealous Fool. He was channeling Brian May. Now on this one was more of a straight ahead rock and roll song. So Paul layered all of these very psychedelic backwards guitars and guitars that were panned and things like that. And he's such a tremendous guitar player. This once again gets back to the part of the Amuse Me story where things weren't going so well, you know. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, you know, the way I could vent my spleen was to write rock and roll songs about it. So
of course,
when you're writing a song about to a girl called You're Dragging Me Right Down, it's not very nice. But, you know, I will thank her for this. I mean, if it hadn't have been such a volatile relationship, I wouldn't have written these songs, you know. If
sure.
It was all fairies and elves, it would have been all love ballads. But as it turned out, there was only a couple songs on the record that were sort of like that. The rest of them were letting you go gets easier each day.
Yeah, sure. That's great. It's called You're Dragging Me Right Down. And you're listening to Reality Radio 101. And the song is Greg Godovitz's solo album, Amuse Me, You're Dragging Me Right Down. Let's have a listen to that.
There's no sense in complaining. No one is listening, you know. But this whole thing's been so draining, and it's time for me to go. But there's a lesson to be learned here, one that everyone should know. You know I read it in the Bible, what you reap is what you sow. I said you're dragging me right now. You're dragging me right down. Well, I wail with mournful sound, because you're dragging me right down. I said you're dragging me right down. You're dragging me right down. Well, I wail with mournful sound, because you're dragging me right down. You're dragging me right down. You're dragging me.
You are listening to This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101. And now, right back to your host, the Baritone Bear, Barry Smith.
Hey, welcome back, listeners. We have Greg Godovitz on the show tonight, and what a show it is. I mean, this guy has been around the town and back, all the amazing stuff that he's done and stories to tell. And because of that and all the emails I'm getting, we're going to continue on to late 15. I'm getting an extra 15 minutes with Greg Godovitz. How freaking cool is that tonight? So that's awesome. Now, Greg, before we move forward, I got an email from Jennifer. She says, hello, I had such a crush on Greg. I live in New York City now, but when I lived in Toronto, I would try to follow Goddo wherever they played. I was always very intrigued by the man behind the glasses. So sexy. Hello, Greg. Come and rescue me. Ha! Jennifer.
I'm actually sitting here blushing. Thank you,
Jennifer. You could get in trouble for this.
No. Mrs. Claypool is pretty cool about this stuff.
Oh, there you go.
Thank you, Jennifer. That's very kind of you to say that. the girls like the band for some reason, you know, and I see the old footage and I can sort of see why. I mean, you know, the band kicked it on stage and, you know, we dressed up a bit and we hid behind sunglasses. So there you go.
The music, like, you know what? The music is sexy, bud. It's just as simple as that. So let's be, it's hard rocking stuff. And you had a lot of Chantel. You had a lot of lovely love songs. Girls love that too. So, I know exactly where they're coming from as far as, having some great music there. Great story about Head and West. This is another one from Thomas Mitchell. Great story about Head and West. So glad that he's back and keeping busy. And that he found the love of a good woman. Great humor, so honest and engaging. Canadian rock royalty. I agree, Thomas. There you go. Greg, let's talk about your book, man, Travels with My Amp. Tell me all about that, how that got started, how you got intrigued to write a book. And I haven't read it yet, but you can be sure I'm going to get it and read it. So let's talk about that. Just don't tell me everything in it or else I won't need to buy it.
I'll send you a copy. What happened was I got a call from Dave Bedini, the writer he played with the Rheostatics, and he was doing a book which became On a Cold Road, it was called. And he called me up and came to my house and we sat down for an interview and he said, tell me some stories about your days on the road. So I ended up with 22 pages of my stories in Dave's book. And then all of a sudden,
wow.
the Toronto Star, Peter Goddard, came out with a review of On a Cold Road, which is a really good read. Mm-hmm. And he said, a lot of the stories, now this, I'm quoting Peter Goddard now, the writer. He said, a lot of the stories in the book are sort of mundane, with the exception of Greg Godovitz, who should clearly write his own book. And I read this, and I put the paper down and started working on it that day. Now, even through all the madness that was going on for like 30 odd years, I kept fairly accurate diaries of everything we did, like a diary writing where we were, how the gigs went, all that kind of stuff, but also kept all the press clippings and photographs, literally tens of thousands of them.
Wow.
So when I started writing the book, I basically spent the first couple of weeks putting all the Fludd stuff in one pile, all the backdoor blues band stuff in a pile, all the Sherman and Peabody stuff in a pile, all the Goddo stuff in a pile, all the Fludd stuff in a pile. And then I got all the diaries, and basically it was easy to write that book. It took a long time to do it, but it was pretty easy to write it.
It did take a long time.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I wrote the whole first draft as one paragraph. but there wasn't any paragraphs. And this guy that was going to put the book out contacted me. He says, have you ever read a book? And I went, yeah, I'm a voracious reader. Why do you ask? He goes, you've written a 350-page paragraph. You have to break it up. So then I had to go back and redo it and, like, you know, paragraph everything. I didn't think
sure,
about it. I wrote it as stream of consciousness. But people seemed to really like it, you know, because it was truthful. It was what it was like to be a guy from small town Canada, Scarborough, Ontario.
Cool.
That, you know, got to, you know, live the dream, you know?
Absolutely. And you know what? Eric Burden from The Animals actually said, I thought I was a rock and roll wild man until I read Greg's book. That's quite a compliment.
Well, you know, I'm glad you brought that up. One day I'm sitting at home and the phone rings. And I said, hello. And he goes, is this Greg Godovitz? And I went, yeah. He goes, it's Eric Burden. And I went, get the bleep out of here. And I didn't believe it was Eric Burden. And he got my number from a friend of mine named Jeff Crabe, who was an Edmonton Journal writer who co-wrote one of Eric's books. And he'd lent Eric my book. And Eric called me up and said, basically what you just said, I thought I was a wild man until I read your book. And we sort of became friends, you know, like he came out to Calgary and he got me tickets for his show. And I have a story actually in my new book, which is called Up Close and Uncomfortable, which should be coming out this year sometime, hopefully.
Mm-hmm.
Called Playing Hide and Seek with Eric Burden.
Wow.
Because he came to do a show in Winnipeg, and Goddo flew out to do it. And when he arrived at the hotel, one of the roadies called me up and said, "Your twin brother just checked into the hotel." And I'm jumping up and down on the bed going, "I'm going to meet Eric Burden," you know, like a little kid. And my girlfriend said to me, she says, no, "You're going to sit there like an adult. And for once in your life, you're not going to be a fanboy. You're going to be cool. And you're not going to go running down." I said, "I'm going to meet Eric Burden. He wants to meet me." So
how cool is that?
Days, we never got to meet each other.
Wow. Wow.
I mean, it was terrible. One guy came up to me at the desk, the front desk, and he said, "Sir, can I have your autograph?" And I said, "Sure." And he passed me a bunch of Animals records. He thought I was Eric Burden.
That is just too funny. Now, from 2006 to 2008, you co-hosted and produced a rock talk for News Talk 1010 CFRB in Toronto. And you interviewed Eric Burden, Meatloaf, Alice Cooper. You interviewed Patty Boyd, Harrison, Stephen Lukather, Roger McGuinn, and countless other rock and roll legends. What was that like, man?
Well, it was pretty cool because, you know, I was looking for something new to do. And I had my blank computer screen in front of me, and I put the words Rock Talk up. And I thought, I'll write a two-page proposal on a sitting around a campfire kind of, or sitting around a kitchen table kind of show.
Mm-hmm.
And it was basically, once they agreed to do it, I would call up the record companies and say, "Who's in town?" And they go, "Ray Davis from the Kinks is in town." Well, one of my favorite bands and writers of all time. So I went down to the hotel to interview Ray. He wouldn't come to the station. He wouldn't let me into his hotel suite. Instead, he had his handlers bring out the couch from the suite into the corridor, into the hallway. And all the questions I asked him, he answered with, unlike myself, with one-word answers. Monosyllabic one-word answers. So Ray, blah, blah, blah. So finally I said to him, I said, "You know, Ray, I've always looked at you as the Charles Dickens of rock." And he went, "Really?" And then I knew I had him. We ended up singing together, you know? And it was Eric Burden was my first guest. And I opened the show by singing one of his songs which was actually a John Lee Hooker song. And I said, "So that's a John Lee Hooker?" He says, "No, it's not. I wrote that." I said, "No, you didn't." So it was that kind of show. You know, it was loosey goosey, much like your great show.
Oh, that's awesome, man. I appreciate that. We got an email from John T. He says, so many memories. Fantastic music. Love Greg and Godo. Pure Canadian made. Reunion tour, please." And John is sending us a message from Prince Albert, Saskatchewan.
Jesus. We played Prince Albert back in the day. Because we played every high school in Canada when we were on tour. In fact, I still get letters from a place called Churchbridge, Saskatchewan, where we were driving through and we had a transport truck with our stuff, and we had CB radios in those days, and we were in the van. You know, we Goddo never had a bus. The best thing we ever had was a Winnebago, but at this point it was a transport truck for the gear and then a van. And we stopped for gas, and I see this high school. All Churchbridge was at the time was, there was a bar, there was a gas station, there was a high school, and a water tower. So we sent our road manager and said, "Look, we've got this Toronto band. They'd like to play a free concert for you tonight, and you can give the money to the school." And so we set up we got the truck to come back, and we set up the full concert system in the high school gym. People came, I don't know where the heck they came from, but it was packed. And we came out wearing the high school band uniforms, which looked like Sergeant Pepper uniforms. I had mine for a long time. And I still get people saying, "You know, we know that you had a night off, but you still did this gig for our school." We played so many small, out of the way places. And it was an amazing feeling to hook up with people in the hinterland of our great country.
Absolutely. And let's face it, man, you're playing for these teenage kids in high schools, and you're playing all the high schools from one end of the country to the other. And who are going to be your fans as they grow up? Like I did, man, like all the young kids, they grow up with your music. You know, those are the people to hit, right? All the teenage kids in the high schools.
So think that, about it. I mean, Rush played high schools.
Rush, Sweetheart, Max Webster.
Max Webster. All of us did those gigs back in the day. I mean, that's where you could play and actually make a decent. It wasn't like playing the clubs for no money. You could actually go in and make $500 at a high school, which was a fortune back in the day.
Absolutely. Message from Ray Y. He says, Greg, a question for Greg. What gives you the inspiration to write such amazing songs? Real life fantasy. Thanks. So real life or fantasy, where do you get the inspiration from? I know for me, Greg, I usually pick up my acoustic guitar and write, play a couple of notes or a riff and then record it on my phone, put it away, and then get back to it a couple weeks or a month later and turn it into a song. So yeah, as you can imagine, I have like 50 different riffs on my phone that I go back to. How about you? How do you write a song?
Dude, you just answered my question or answered Ray's question. That's exactly what I do. But, you know, the funny thing is that for me, sometimes these songs just appear out of thin air. I can see them. Now, let me ask you this. Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
The music off the top of your show, is that one of your songs?
Yes, it is.
Well, I was going to tell you when we came off the thing, that's a really good song. Super hook.
Thank you. Much appreciated. I did that with Josh Hinnan from Classy Chassis, which we're going to have to stop and take a commercial break for them right now, right after we talk right here for a second or two. But me and Josh got together. He owns a motorcycle shop in up around Lakefield called Classy Chassis. We got together, and I wrote the music, and he's singing the song. He wrote the words to the song. So
it's a really good, catchy tune, so congrats. But the songs... Like, I've never had to really struggle over them. They just sort of come really fast. On the inside credit notes of Amuse Me, I've got all the original lyrics. And there's very few words that are crossed out. They just sort of came out stream of consciousness. So I'll be driving in my car or I'll be in the shower, and they just sort of appear, you know?
Me too. They just come out of nowhere.
Aliens.
It's incredible. Yep. Go ahead, Greg. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to say aliens, I'm pretty sure, are delivering me my songs. I just wish they'd send me better, better lyrics. Yeah.
No, absolutely. I get it. Sometimes they just come out of nowhere. What gets me is some nights I'll be dreaming a song and wake up, at least think it would be a number one hit in the whole world, and wake up and forget what it was. I've had a couple of those and they drive me crazy, but...
The way I look at it is, if you can't remember it the next morning, it wasn't worth remembering.
Yeah, maybe so. Well, it's great that we could have some extended time here, but I do have to stop for our sponsor, Greg. So just give me a couple of a minute or so here, and we're going to stop for a commercial here from our sponsor. You're listening to Reality Radio 101, and we'll be right back with Greg Godovitz.
At Classy Chassis and Cycles, we have the absolute best motorcycles available for sale and the best live music for your entertainment. It doesn't get any better than this. Get your motorcycle serviced by our V-Twin performance specialists, and always 100 motorcycles in stock. Hungry while looking? Try our delicious on-site food truck meal specials. It's all happening at Classy Chassis and Cycles. Call us today at 888-292-8305. That's 888-292-8305. Or visit our website, usedhd.ca, or send us an email. Our email address is info@usedhd.ca. Classy Chassis and Cycles. Motorcycles, music, and food. All for the motorcyclists in your life. Welcome back to this House of Musicians with your host, the Baritone Bear, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. To get on board, send us an email right now. Our email address is thishouseofmusicians@gmail.com. And now, right back to your host of This House of Musicians, Barry Smith.
Hey, welcome back, listeners. Greg, what a wonderful compliment to give me about the song Josh and I put together there at the beginning of the show that we put together not too long ago. Coming from you, man, that is such a great compliment. I want to go back and talk about Pretty Bad Boy. We discussed it a little earlier. Just touch on that a little bit more for me, and we're going to play the song.
Okay. One thing I got to quickly ask you, Lakefield, that's where you're broadcasting from?
Nope, I'm in Bowmanville. Gary, the producer, because we're doing everything from Zoom from home. So I'm in Bowmanville. Gary's in Whitby, Oshawa, like the borderline Whitby, Oshawa. And that's where we're doing this from.
Convention. Okay, my mistake. Pretty Bad Boy. I mean, it was the biggest record that Goddo ever had. I mean, it was on the Chum chart for like 38 weeks or something crazy like that.
And where did it come from?
Well, like I said earlier, you know, I was always being accused of being the bad boy of Canadian rock. So I just wrote a song. I'm just a pretty bad boy, and you know, bring over your girlfriend and let's see what happens. And you know, it was just one of those songs. But we didn't expect it to have the longevity that it had, and the fact that you know it's been played a lot of times on Canadian radio. You know.
Oh. Millions. Okay, so let's go ahead and play it. You are listening to Pretty Bad Boy from the band Goddo. Greg Godovitz is on our show here on Reality Radio 101.
Make eyes after
That's Goddo, Pretty Bad Boy, right here on Reality Radio 101, this house of musicians. And now, right back to your host, Barry Smith.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. Gary, thank you so much for letting us go a little longer. I'm going to request a lot more time next time we have Greg on the show. So much to talk about, and it's just so hard to squeeze it all in. I do have one last email I want to read from Catherine H. Which song, Greg, do you find is the hardest to play live but enjoyable at the same time? And what is your favorite song to perform live? And do you ever get tired of performing, which you already answered? Of course you don't. But what song do you like the best to play?
I guess it's a toss-up for me between Under My Hat and Sweet Thing. Because yep. no matter what, you know, we do the overture and a kind of panic, and then we do So Walk On, everybody seems to like that. Then we get to Under My Hat, people seem to like that. But when we hit the riff for Sweet Thing, I mean, it's like everybody goes crazy. And of course, if everybody's going crazy, it sounds lovely and friendly. And why wouldn't you love it? So I'd have to say it's got to be that one. But, you know, there's just so many. I mean, you know, I want to thank everybody for listening that, you know, took the time to write in and stuff. I still can't believe that I've had a career that started in 1964 and, you know, we're in 2020 and everything that's going on, and people still care about what we did. And I, from the bottom of my heart, I want to thank everybody. Please go to my YouTube, Greg Godovitz YouTube. If you have any questions, leave them there. We're going to have some surprises coming up. Subscribe. Find me on Facebook. I'll let as many people as I can on it. And I want to thank Gary and Barry for having me on the show tonight. I had a great time on here.
You're welcome.
Hey, man. And also to the listener, be sure and get out there. And you can look online. Amazon and Google Play have all of Greg's songs from Amuse Me, his solo album. Be sure and get out there and purchase some of his songs. The whole album's fabulous. Buy some Goddo songs. Greg has been a wonderful guy to talk to. I've talked to him on the phone 3 or 4 times. Just a down-to-earth, awesome guy and a cool dude to collaborate with and talk to. So it's hard to find that in this business. And I really appreciate you being on the show, Greg. And next time I have you on, we're going to go as long as I can get with you, my man. So thank you so much for being here. It means a lot.
2 days, Barry. Next time is 2 full days.
2 full days. Yeah, that'll keep people... We'll give everybody perks and keep them interested for 2 days. That's what we'll have to do.
All you people listening in, stay safe during this pandemic. You know, let's get through this together. You know, wear your masks, wear your gloves, social distance. Do everything we have to do to get through this thing because, you know, we don't know exactly what's going on here. But if we all work together, we're going to get through this.
Absolutely. Just keep doing whatever. Canada has been a great country as far as the folks here doing what they have to do to get through this pandemic, and we're doing a great job. Let's keep it up, guys. And also to the listener, I say thank you for being here, and always dance and sing and let the music bring your soul to the surface for all the world to see. Until next time, have a shuffle your feet kind of week, and good night. Because you've been listening to This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101. Thank you again, Greg.
Thank you for listening to This House of Musicians, the radio show, right here on Reality Radio 101.
Let's ride, heading up 35. One way we're headed at 90K. Over the two-lane causeway. We'll go left, it's gonna be a classy day.